Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Isn't it incredible that a gospel opportunity can fit in your hands? It's called an Operation Christmas Child shoebox, and it's filled with fun toys, hygiene items, school supplies, and a personal message. But really, it's much more than that. It's a tangible expression of God's love to introduce Jesus Christ. Churches just like this, when they pack shoeboxes, have a significant gospel impact around the world.
In the beginning, people from this village, they were hard-hearted to receive the gospel. The turning point was when we distributed gift boxes. I saw a great impact. After the distribution, many of children gave their life to Jesus and started with the greatest journey. The greatest journey is so impactful because it's the word of God. I've seen Jesus putting hope upon the children. God is doing a great work.
If you want something as a pastor where your people can get involved in ministry, something that has maximum impact in the worldwide kingdom of Christ, I mean, what better thing could you do than be involved in Operation Christmas Child? To me, it's a no-brainer.
I have seen firsthand how a shoebox is an opportunity and a tool that opens the door to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
These boxes open kids' hearts to the fact that there's people all over the world that love them, and what it shows them ultimately is that there's a God that loves them.
This is one of many shoebox distributions we've been doing on the Nation of Kiribati.
We have brought tens of thousands of shoebox gifts. And even though it's August, it's Christmas for these children.
Scripture tells us, go throughout all ends of the earth and bring the good news of Jesus Christ to make fishers of men. That's what we've been called to do. And that's what I love about Operation Christmas Child. It knows no borders and knows no boundaries. It's all about sharing the name of Jesus Christ.
Each year, around 11 million gospel opportunities are shared in over 120 countries. And more than 4 million children enroll in the greatest journey and learn to be disciples. The gospel is truly going to the ends of the earth. Your local church is having a massive impact, all because of the simple act of packing a shoebox. These shoebox gifts create an opportunity for entire congregations to fulfill the Great Commission. With every shoebox you pack, your church is empowering and training churches globally to share the gospel. This is truly the Great Commission in action.
Well, hey, church. For those of you that don't know, we are, as a church, are committed to the mission and vision of Samaritan's Purse with Operation Christmas Child. If you have any questions about how you can get involved with that, every Friday this month, we are going to be meeting to help pack and get things ready for that. And if you have any other questions beyond that, you can talk to Miss Kathy Merrill. She's going to stand and wave if she's back there. There she is. So if you have questions about Operation Christmas Child, reach out to her. Let's go ahead and stand together, and we'll enter into a time of worship.
I was buried beneath my shame. Chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name, shout it.
Remain standing. A couple of quick announcements, though. We are going to be starting a young adult ministry here at the church, and the first meeting for that is tomorrow, Monday, at 6 p.m. So if you are between the ages of 18 to 29, we would love for you to come out and be a part of that. Also, our back-to-school bash that we had planned for the day is going to be canceled out at Brown Road. There's just going to be too much rain, too much moisture out there. That's going to be really muddy, and so we just aren't going to be able to do it. So that's canceled. Other than that, let's continue in worship. Yes, youth. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting.
never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God is never late. He's working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Jesus, Jesus, precious Lord, none on the earth or heavens above that I have found more beautiful. You are my treasure, my great reward. I just want to move your heart. That's all I want. Jesus, Jesus, my offering, all my ambitions, my hopes, my dreams, in here's my life, a sacrifice, or just to bless you. I just want to move your heart. It's all I want to do. I just want to stand in awe and pour my love on you, no matter how much the cost. I freely give it all to you. Oh, to you. I just want to move. Tell me what moves you. Is it a fragrance? Then I'll pour my oil out. Is it a light laid down? Then here I give my vows. Is it a song I sing? Then here's every melody. Just tell me what moves you. Just tell me what moves you. Is it a fragrance?
just wanna sit here at your feet, caught up in this holy moment. Never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings, Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry. Just sing another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Back to where we started, I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. Humbled in your presence in this moment. We're humbled in your presence. everything in this world, all the things going on around us, at the end of the day, they don't matter. But just you. Nothing else but just you. So as Richard comes and prepares to bring a message to us today, God, I ask that you would open our hearts. Continue to meet us in this place, to be here with us, God. And I pray an anointing over Richard, God. Thank you for all you've done for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
I think I turned it on down there and turned it off when I got up here, so that's what I did. Oh, do we? We have children's church this morning then. Children, you can go to children's church. Thank you, Nancy. Awesome. So all you kids, if you'd like to go to children's church, we have it. All right, good. Hey, do you have your sheet here? Your steps of discipleship. If you don't, where are the paper steps of discipleship? Are they right out there? Somebody grab those for me. Wes, thank you. I appreciate it. If you'd like to have one, raise your hand. We'd like for you to have one. I'd like for everyone to have one. Maybe you're keeping it with you, maybe you're not, but you need one. Okay, it's important. As we think about where we want to go, we just went and dropped our second oldest, Susanna, off at NC State. And guess what? I needed a map to get there. It was my GPS. And I wouldn't have made it without that map, especially if you saw me walking around this morning. I had a mask on. Well, we were down at NC State, and they have 34,000 students at NC State on that campus. 26,000 of them are undergrads, and I think all of them and their parents were there yesterday. So it was a madhouse. Glad to do it. Everyone was wearing masks. I just thought I was around a lot of people, so as I walked around the church this morning, I wanted to put a mask on. There is no mandate in our church to wear a mask, but it is completely optional. Now, I can't say that something's not going to happen where we will have to mandate it. Hopefully we won't, but that's why, if you saw me with a mask on, that's why I was wearing it. But we were, as you can imagine, parents a little worried about dropping Susanna off at NC State. Here she is with 26,000 new friends, and we said, see you later, sink or swim, as we left, right? You know, you just have to trust, don't you? You trust that you've raised them the right way. They've got ambitions and goals and things that they want to do and obtain, and we're trusting that she's going to focus on those things. And I told her, have fun too. You know, this is a time of your life. Enjoy college. Enjoy making new friends and doing this. But, you know, make good decisions. Make good decisions and buckle down and study so you can obtain your goals. And she has some high goals. So we were down there. And we dropped her off. I want to talk to you this morning in our steps of discipleship more about assurance. We might even be here another week. I imagine we will be. But we're talking about our roadmap of discipleship, of faith. We started with prevenient grace, this first step, that God's calling us when we don't even know He's calling us. We don't know anything about Him, but He's wooing us to Him. And we talked about that second step, how we realize there's a God and it's not us, and we're not worthy. and there's sin in our lives, and we need to repent of our sins and seek Him and ask Him into our hearts. And that's that convicting grace, right? When we're convicted and we do repent and we ask Him in our hearts. And now here we find ourselves landing on assurance. And I've told you and I'll tell you again, I think most of the church hangs right here on saving grace. They're saved, but that's as far as they go. It's the tip of the iceberg, I said, right? Now, you knew there's a God, you got convicted, you got saved, but you don't know Him, right? It's time to get some assurance that all His promises are true, that everything He says, you can count on it, that His Word is true, right? You want that assurance that every time you hear that preacher on the radio, or every time you come to church and they ask you to say this little prayer and ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins, that you're saved, that you don't have to say it again. You're sure you know that you know. Assurance is a positive declaration intended to give confidence. Confidence in your faith. God can assure you that all His promises are true. But you got to want it. You got to seek Him, right? This week, I spent some time behind the lawnmower cleaning up the yard. And as I'm cutting the grass and doing some weeding and cleaning up the yard, the Lord is speaking to me like crazy. And I had to just turn the lawnmower off and go get my phone. And then I'd have to cut a strip, and I'd have to turn the lawnmower off and write down what He was telling me. And then I'd have to start to mow again, and just things are flooding in my mind. I don't mean audibly, but I mean within my spirit, He's talking to me, right? I want to tell you, I wrote this whole message this morning behind the lawnmower. You don't have to be behind a desk. You don't have to be in some certain area. God can speak to you wherever you are if you're open to it, right? And God was speaking to me in ways I knew I had to go get my phone and write down what He was saying. And then when I looked at my notes 2 days later, I was like, what in the world was I thinking? But it did jog my memory as I started thinking again more about what God was saying to me. First thing God was telling me about, as we're talking about steps to discipleship, are you out there, are you looking at these steps of discipleship? Are you thinking about where you are and where you want to go, how God's working in your life? Or do you say, preacher, get on with it. It's a bunch of hogwash. I don't know where you are. I've sat in church services thinking this is a bunch of hogwash in the past, right? I remember as a young person, I was made to go to church. Why do I have to go? This is hogwash. I started thinking about the meaning of hogwash. And as I'm cutting grass, I have figured out the meaning of hogwash. We know if you look it up, there are words that mean hogwash. Nonsense. It's nonsense. It's gibberish. It's blather. That's hogwash. And I thought, well, where did that word come from? And I thought, well, farmers looked at their hogs and they thought, those hogs are dirty. I need to wash those hogs. They're dirty. And so they take these hogs and they wash them clean just to put them back in the pen so they can wallow all in the mud again, right? Hogwash. I got to thinking too, hogs are a lot smarter than people. As soon as you wash them and clean them, they're exposed, that pink skin exposed to the sun, and they go wallow in that mud as their sunscreen to protect them, right? So I'm feeling all good about my definition or epistemology, is that how you say it? My origin of where this word came from, thinking it up. And then I look it up online. Where did this word come from? Well, guess what? Back in the 14 to 1600s, people would have buckets, and they would take old scraps of meat and old vegetables and rotten things and all kinds of stuff and just throw them in the bucket along with dirty water. And then they would take it out to the hogs. It was all nonsense. It was just debris. It was junk nobody wanted, and they'd take it to the hogs, and they'd throw it out, and the hogs would eat it. That's hogwash. Isn't that interesting? But it's still, that's the real origin of where that word came from. But it still means the same. It's nonsense. It's gibberish. It's blather. How are you when you think about God and His Word? Do you think that it's nourishment to the soul? Or do sometimes you think it's just a bunch of hogwash? As I'm trying to encourage you, as I'm trying to prove to you the importance of being a disciple these few weeks that we've been on this path, I want to try to convince you that what I'm telling you and this chart and our steps to discipleship is not hogwash. My question to you this morning is, do you want to be a disciple? Or are you happy to be the mainstream worldly Christian hanging right here on saving grace? And you may be saved and you might not be saved. I don't know. But if you're right there and you've made it to that step, salvation has come. I don't want to stay there. Look, that's step three. There's so many more steps of growing in the Lord, right? I want to tell you that God spoke to me in some pretty profound ways this week because of my preaching. God's been telling me, Richard, if you're going to preach these things, you better live these things. If you're going to say these things, then why aren't you doing what you're preaching about? And I've been very convicted by my own preaching this week. In fact, I will tell you, staff, Kayla and Wes, as we were singing, I'm convicted about I don't want to be dogmatic about the direction we go, okay? So just rest assured, don't worry about those things. You know, I'm a work in progress. How about you? Are you a work in progress? I am a work in progress. And sometimes the Lord has to work extra hard. On Richard. I talked to you last week about being a legalistic, legalized Christian. I talked to you last week, that legalistic Christian is the one trying to hold everybody to their standards, right? Even the lost, trying to hold them to the standards of God's Word. And they can't even do it themselves. I talked to you last week about being a mainstream Christian, a worldly kind of just right there, a saved Christian, but that's as far as you care to go. And I talked to you last week about wanting to be a disciple, a follower, a Christ, a true follower. And then it happens. Early in the week, I got in a fight with one of my daughters. I got into a fight with one of my daughters about her not doing what I expect her to do. I have high expectations for you. You're not doing this. You're not doing that. What in the world? Why are you not making the right choices and doing what you're supposed to be doing? Well, you know how well that went over, right? So before long, my daughter and I are at odds. Rightfully so. When she went away in tears, I'm thinking to myself, I didn't mean to say any of those things I said in the way I said them. It was angry and hateful. And it was completely against everything I'd preached about on Sunday. Being legalistic, holding her to my standards and what I expect of her, and telling her what she needs to be doing. God convicted me on that. It wasn't until Wednesday. This happened early in the week. And by Wednesday, I'd been chewing on it for a couple of days and still not really ready to let go of it. And here I am driving a wedge between me and my daughter. On Wednesday night, we've been talking about the book of Ecclesiastes. And we've been talking about King Solomon. I want to tell you a little bit of what I've learned about the book of Ecclesiastes and King Solomon. King Solomon has it all. He's the king. 700 wives of royal birth, 300 concubines, castles, temples, big cities, parks, reservoirs. He's built it. He's done it all. Anything he desired, anything he wanted to do, he could do it. He was the king. Didn't matter. He could do it. And as he gets older, King Solomon, he's become cynical. Now, I want to remind you, at a young age, when he took the throne, King Solomon was visited by God. And God said, King Solomon, because you asked for wisdom, I'm going to give you more wisdom than anyone ever had. And I'm going to give you everything that comes with it, all the riches, all the glory, everything. King Solomon had it all, wisest man that ever lived at that time. But as we get to the end of his life and we read about him, the wisest man seemed very stupid. A little bit, you can read all of 1 Kings 1 through, I don't know, it's 1 through 15 or so, but a little bit of it. 1 Kings 11, 9 through 10. Later in his life, the Lord was very angry with Solomon, for his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice. He had warned Solomon specifically about worshiping other gods, but Solomon did not listen to the Lord's command. You see, Solomon wanted to do what Solomon wanted to do. He was the king, privileged in every way. Literally born with the golden spoon in his mouth, right? Had it all. But as you read the book of Ecclesiastes, and I challenge you to open it up and read it and listen to the heart of a cynical person, a cynical man, trying to find meaning in life, but it's all meaningless. The chasing after the wind, can't find any meaning in any of it. Being cynical is believing that people are only motivated by self-interest. It's being distrustful of human sincerity and integrity. And that was Solomon. Now, here's where we might have some issues this morning. I believe that every word in the Bible is the inspired word of God. You believe that? I do. I believe every word in the Bible is the inspired word of God. Now, here's the twist. I don't believe every word in the Bible is true. Let me tell you why. Because God uses people like King Solomon, a cynical old king, to give his viewpoints and his thoughts of a life that's completely meaningless to make us run to God. He had it all, and he couldn't find any satisfaction. Now I want to prove my point to you. Every word is inspired. God gave Solomon these words to write down. God put it in his holy word. But some of it's not true. Listen to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, 18 through 22. He's trying to figure out life. I also thought about the human condition, how God proves to people that they are like animals. For people and animals share the same fate. Both breathe and both must die. So people have no real advantage over the animals. How meaningless. Both go to the same place. They came from dust and they return to dust. Who can prove that the human spirit goes up and the spirit of animals go down into the earth? So I saw there's nothing better for people than to be happy in their work. That is our lot in life. And no one can bring us back to see what happens after we die. As I started reading Ecclesiastes and Solomon's word, you know what I said? Hogwash! Everything Solomon just said is hogwash. It's senseless. Now, I want to tell you this too. A person that doesn't believe in God and doesn't believe in the Bible, they love Ecclesiastes. Oh, hey, open up your book of Ecclesiastes, Christian. Look what it says. You're no different than the animals. You're all the same. Who knows if there's a heaven or hell? Who knows where people go? Who knows? The only thing you can find joy in is your work. It's hogwash. Let me just tell you, you and I are made in the image of God. We're in His image. We are the pinnacle of His creation. And Jennifer, I quoted it in the first service, and we were almost about to get there in Hebrews chapter 2 in Sunday school this morning. The whole first part of Hebrews is trying to prove that Jesus did not come to the angels. Jesus did not come to save anyone, but those made in the image of God. Abraham's descendants. And it says that he too became flesh and blood so he might destroy the one who holds the grip of death. That's the devil. And then it was to Abraham's children that Jesus came to. We are special. Oh, Solomon doesn't have a clue. You see, he had become cynical. His heart had turned away from God. And God was angry with him, and he was doing his own thing, even in the book of Ecclesiastes. But that's what's so cool about it. And what's so awesome about it being God's inspired word is we see real things and real life struggles and real events of people. And we can read the words of Solomon and say, no, God has so much more for us. It's all in the rest of His word. We're in His image. There is a heaven. Jesus said, I've gone to prepare a place for you. If it wasn't true, I wouldn't have told you. And I'm coming back to get you, to take you where I am. We're that special. Oh, sure. We breathe just like the animals and we die, but there's difference. And I want to tell you, I don't find all my satisfaction in my work. Old cynical Solomon did, because he had 700 wives and 300 concubines and no real relationships. I think he was a lonely, cynical king. Nobody was as wise as him. No one could live up to his expectations. He couldn't even relate to people. He was so wise and so smart, but he was lonely and he was cynical. And then it hit me, Richard. Here you are preaching about legalism. And here you are judging your daughter, putting your expectation. You've become cynical in your faith, exactly what you're preaching against. I want to tell you, I had to humbly go and ask for her forgiveness. I didn't say any buts. I'm sorry, but, right? Oh, man, I was dug in. I was right, right? But Lord said, you're wrong. I want to tell you another one. And Tara, I need to apologize to you, because as I'm thinking about this message, Tara's been telling me several times this week, quit picking on me. And I know how to push her buttons, right? And she doesn't behave the way I want her to. So I push those buttons. And she says, you're picking on me. And you know what my response is? No, I'm not. You're just too sensitive. Right? Come on now. I'm being real. Fact of the matter is, when I got alone, Lord's saying, you're picking on her. And you need to quit it. I'm sorry. I'll probably do it again. I'm a work in progress. But I am sorry. Truly sorry. So as I'm pushing the lawnmower, and God's speaking to me, here's some things he's telling me. Why do you want this assurance? Why do you want to be a disciple anyways? I mean, isn't salvation just enough? What's the big deal about having assurance, a confidence in God? I mean, heck, he saved you. Just believe it and go on. Well, God started talking to me. Oh, no, no. Salvation is just the beginning. I've got an abundant life for you. So much more if you'll trust me. I drive a 2006 Toyota Tundra. And that Toyota Tundra has 180,000 miles on it. Going to drive it forever, I hope. I don't know. But you know what? There are things that happen to it. It'll have little breakdowns here and there. A fuse will go out or something will happen. And when something happens, I think to myself, I can fix this, right? And so, what do? This isn't working. Boop. Hit the button on the dash, and the glove box opens up, and there's my manual. You see, the people at Toyota, they know everything about this Toyota Tundra. They manufactured all the parts. They machined and tooled everything. They know that Toyota Tundra inside and out because they created it. And so, I go to the manual to try to figure out what's going on with my truck. And that's my first point the Lord told me about why you should want to be a disciple. Because the Creator knows best how to care for the creation. You know, the Lord God made us. He knew us before He knit us in the womb. He knows everything about you. He knows every hair on your head. He knows it all. He is your Creator. And He's given us an instruction manual. An instruction manual for life. Oh, if I'm having trouble in life and in my walk, I need to go to the instruction manual and find out what's going on and how I can fix it, how I can be better, right? God is our Creator, and He knows best how to care for His creation. Therefore, we can trust Him. I don't question what that Toyota manual says about my truck. I want to tell you this too, my second point. The Lord told me this is why you want to be a disciple. This is why you want to have assurance. You see, Jesus, God, through Jesus, offers you and I real peace. Here's the crazy thing. There's nothing you have to do but take it to receive it. It's a gift. God, through Jesus Christ, offers us the gift of real peace. And come on now, if you've opened that gift and you know the peace of God, then you understand that peace that passes all understanding, right? Oh, the world looks at you and thinks you're crazy. And you've got this peace and contentment in your heart that you know God gave you. It's a gift. God gives it to you as a present. And He says, here, I want to give you a gift. Will you open it? Will you accept it? In John chapter 14, Jesus is about to go to the cross and He's talking to His disciples. And in John chapter 14, 27 through 29, listen to what He says. I am leaving you with a gift, He's telling His disciples. Peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. Remember what I told you. I'm going away, but I will come back to you again. If you really love me, you would be happy that I'm going to the Father who is greater than I am. I have told you these things before they happen so that when they do happen, you will believe. Guys, here's a gift I'm leaving you. Peace of mind and peace of heart. How wonderful is that? Will you receive that gift? Will you open it? Do you want to be a disciple? Or do you just want to struggle right there, knowing if you're saved or you're not saved? Worried about going on to that same old sin that keeps pulling you away? Or do you want that gift of God, that peace that passes all understanding? Another reason why you ought to want to be a disciple. Go further than just step three. Get that assurance. And I love this one as a pastor. If you accept the gift that Jesus offers of peace, then you're truly free. You're truly free from all the pressure of this life that's saying it's all up to you. That's what we do, don't we? We take all the weight of the world and we put it on ourselves and we say it's all up to us to figure it out and get it done. But if you accept His real peace, His gift, peace of mind and peace of heart, then you're free. You're free of all these overwhelming decisions. You're free of thinking that everything is on your shoulders. You can give it to Him. I tell you, that's huge as a pastor. Us pastors, we like to get in the pulpit and think it's our job to proclaim the message so you get saved. Whatever. I'm a work in progress, as you found out today and probably already knew. It is my job to proclaim the gospel, but it's not my job to save you. God does that. And that's freeing to know that I don't have this burden on me that says, oh, I got five saved today. Five said the prayer. Oh, yes, okay. Let me write that down. John chapter 8, verses 34 through 36. Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, woo, you are free indeed. Free from all the pressures of what's COVID going to do to us. Free from all the pressures of politics. Free from all the pressures of living up to social media. You're free. Let me tell you. Creator knows best how to care for His creation. Jesus offers real peace, true freedom from the feeling that it's all up to you. You'll really be free. And being a disciple is healthy. It brings health to you. I don't know, being just on step three, saved, brings a lot of anxiety. Trying to live up to God's standards, thinking I can do it. Wondering if I'm saved, I'm not saved. Now I want to go deeper. And going deeper with the Lord and getting that assurance brings great health. Health. Here's the battle we're all in. It's right here. Between these two things, right? It's that battle of the mind. Running all these rabbit trails. Letting life bring us down and beat us up. Thinking about all these things that could happen and worried all the time. God God wants to give you peace of mind, peace of heart. He wants to set you free from all that. He wants to set you free from those battles within your mind. He wants to make you healthy. Healthy personally, mentally, physically, spiritually. When you give your heart and life to the Lord and you start to seek Him, He starts to speak to you in ways you never believed. It becomes personal. And you have a relationship with the Creator of all the universe. The Father and His Son and the Holy Spirit, the Trinity. Oh, it's personal. It's not religion. It's not do's and don'ts. It's a personal, fulfilling relationship. Oh, He wants to be your friend. He wants to meet you personally where you are. He wants to help with all those mental issues, all those struggles, all those rabbit trails, everything that's trying to beat you up and run you down. He wants you, as 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5 says, He wants you to take every one of those thoughts captive. Listen. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they are divine power to demolish strongholds. Boy, these are strongholds, right? We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Whoo, I had set in on those strongholds earlier this week. I was determined I was right. And the Lord said, let me take that thought captive and make it obedient to me. Oh, mentally, personally, physically, I don't have to tell you, if you're not even a Christian, I don't have to tell you that the way your mind thinks affects your health, right? When I'm in a bad place and I'm thinking bad things, I got a headache. And I'm gritting my teeth, right? Come on now. I mean, the number one of the number one killers of heart, number one contributors to heart disease is what? Stress. Right? The way you think, the way you live affects you physically and your health and spiritually. God says, I've left my Holy Spirit to live and dwell in you, to be your friend and your guide, to be your counselor. It's good I go away because I'm sending the Spirit. And that old spirit of the world is dwelling in you. Now my Spirit can live and dwell in you. All right, so here's the last one. Hey, all this was behind a lawnmower. The Lord speaks, doesn't He? He's just telling me these things in my mind, in my spirit as I'm doing this. Why do we want to be disciples? Well, did you know that I believe those that are saved are going to be in heaven for all eternity? But I also believe those who are the disciples are going to have a different place in heaven. If you're a disciple of Christ, a follower, guess what? The Word tells us we're going to rule with Christ. Now, I ask you this. Do you want to be one who said, I barely made it by the skin of my teeth? That might be good enough with you. Or do you want to rule with Christ for all eternity? Listen to what Revelation chapter 20, 4 through 6 says. I saw thrones on which were seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony about Jesus and because of the Word of God. They had not worshipped the beast or His image and had not received its mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and they reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Look what it says in parentheses. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. There's going to be a 1,000-year millennial reign on earth. And if you're a disciple, you're going to come to life and reign with Christ. Now, I know that's a little, right? But I want to be a disciple. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who share in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with Him for 1,000 years. I don't know about you, but I want to go deeper. I want to be a disciple. I want to know that I know that the Creator knows this creation best. I want that real peace of heart and mind that Jesus Christ can offer in this whole crazy world. I want to be truly free, truly set free and not bound. I want to have health. I want to have health personally, mentally, physically, and spiritually. And I want to rule with Christ. I want to be a disciple. I forgot about the last song we sang and what we were saying over and over again. What were we saying, Wes? Nothing else. Nothing else but Christ will do, right? Nothing else. Nothing else. And I was thinking, nothing else. Nothing else is worthy. Nothing else means anything. And I thought about the words of John the Baptist. I mean, people are coming in droves to John the Baptist. He's baptizing folks. They're repenting of their sin, right? Ministry is going like gangbusters. And along comes Jesus. And suddenly, he's pointing everybody, all his followers, to Jesus. And they all go. And people are saying, John, what's up? Do you realize they're all turning away from you and going to him? And John the Baptist says, praise the Lord. He must become greater, and I must become less. You want to sum up a discipleship, being a disciple in one sentence, that's it, right? Oh, my prayer is, and I hope your prayer is, as we continue steps of discipleship, that He becomes greater and you become less. Praise the Lord. Let's stand this morning. Lord Jesus, we just give you praise for the word you've put in my heart and for your word, Lord. I pray that these words were received and heard. I know if this message wasn't for anyone out there, it's for me. Lord, I'm listening. Lord, help me to hear. Lord, help me to desire. Lord, help me to realize I'm a work in progress and I got a long way to go, but I desire it and I want it. May I remain teachable and humble. Lord, may I cling to your word. That should be all of us, right? Lord, let us not just be satisfied of being saved. May we become disciples, followers of Christ, so that we now have the power and the ability to go make other disciples. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. In Christ's name, amen. You're dismissed this morning.